There's going to be a new auditing chapter on what the employer auditors should do within the state and local audit guide. But embedded within the white paper, the current white papers, it specifically says that the employer auditors, so the people out auditing the school districts, both the employer and the employer's auditors, and I'll pick on Alameda County Office of Education first, their auditors, as well as their management, is responsible for understanding and auditing that $684,786. So it is not as if they are taking these financial statements that or the schedule that CalSTRS provided, and it's absolved them of all responsibility as it relates to their own financial statements for both management as well as the employer's auditors.
Thanks, Kevin. So this just summarizes the codification in which we followed as it relates to the standard, as well as the two additional schedules that I just spoke to and provided you examples of. So I talked a little bit about the challenges of getting comfortable with three different sets of compensation. Certainly, we used information we obtained from each of the employers through our substantive test work. We also used confirmation procedures with the county offices of education. The purpose for that is, in many cases, the employers themselves report to CalSTRS through a CalSTRS Secure Employer website through their county office of education. So that was an additional item that we needed to consider as we came up with our audit approach to get comfortable with the numbers that were actually submitted to the system used to determine contributions. As it relates to the schedule of the aggregate pension amounts, this schedule is largely a byproduct of the audit of the strip that's embedded within the audited financial statements of CalSTRS. Most importantly, the net pension liability. And then in addition to that, under the GASB standards, the calculation of the deferred outflows of resources, inflows of resources, and then total pension expense. In the year of implementation, because the net pension liability that was calculated as of June 30th, 2013, as well as June 30th, 2014, used the same census data or valuation date, if you will, there are no total deferred outflows of resources. You do have total deferred inflows of resources that relate to the actual earnings during the current fiscal year compared to the earnings calculated using the long-term rate of return assumption. Those earnings are then amortized over a five-year period, so the total deferred inflows of resources is actually net of current year amortization expense. And then the total pension expense is really a byproduct of the change in net pension liability considering the deferred inflows and outflows. So now we can actually show you or present to you the results of all the work that we just tried to present to you. But before we do that, and I turn it over to Kevin to do so, any questions about what Crowe is engaged to perform in terms of audits, the approach that we took, the purpose of the employer audits, the sampling methodology that was utilized before we present to you our actually independent auditor's reports on those particular statements?
Well, yeah, Bob.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So just a couple of quick questions. One is, well, I guess just one. So is there an expectation that this is a brand new audit that, for the board's edification? Will this be a permanent part of the CalSTRS audit going forward that now we see two audits? So these school districts audits are not just one time or every other year or every three, but an annual procedure?
Dr. Yatman, that's a great question. So for purposes of performing substantive procedures over the completeness and accuracy of the census data, because the total pension liability is embedded within CalSTRS financial statements as a part of the engagement for Crowe to issue an opinion on the audited financial statements of CalSTRS, we will always do those employer audits. It would be up to management as well as this committee to make a determination as to whether the additional schedules would be performed every single year and whether you would like Crowe to also issue an opinion on those additional schedules. In the event that you did not, we would still conduct those employer audits. Okay, if you want to turn to ARM page 6 in your materials, Kevin is going to go over our first deliverable.
finally we get to what you guys engaged us to do and the results. We have issued, as Brenda said, on ARM page 6, an unmodified opinion on the financial statements. That means we believe that the financial statements are prepared in accordance with generally accepted accounting principles, and we also believe that we performed our audit in accordance with generally accepted auditing standards. Brenda mentioned earlier, you guys actually engage us to perform those audits under two separate set of standards. You have generally accepted auditing standards, which are promulgated by the AICPA, as well as the government auditing standards that come out of the Office of the Comptroller, which set on top, if you will, of the generally accepted auditing standards. Through that auditing process, we have issued an unmodified opinion. If you've been in the business for a while, you might have heard it called an unqualified opinion up until a couple years ago. But that's the type of opinion that you are looking for. We believe it, as I said, it means it's prepared in accordance with generally accepted accounting principles. We do have or have included two emphasis of matters paragraphs. They have no impact upon our opinion. However, although the information is included appropriately within the financial statements and it's disclosed in accordance with generally accepted accounting principles, as a matter of professional judgment, we believe that there are two elements that it is critical for a user of financial statements to understand in order to understand the financial statements taken as a whole. Those two are the net pension liability of $58.6 billion, although much better than the $176 billion that we've referred to earlier that prior to AB 1469, it is still a significant and a large number. So we point the users of the financial statements to that. The second is the amount of alternative investments, and that the valuation is dependent upon both management's procedures as well as ultimately what the general partner states as fair value of those investments. Anytime dealing with alternative investments or those types of investments that are not actively traded, there is a certain amount of subjectivity within the investment balances, and that could have a significant impact both upon current year operations as well as your overall statement of fiduciary net position. Obviously, as part of our auditing process, it's a focal point. We believe that they are valued appropriately, but we do point the users of the financial statements to the significance of that amount. Our opinion also shows or indicates what we're responsible for as well as what management is responsible for. Ultimately, the financial statements are those of management and the opinion is ours. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I'll turn it back over to you to vote on whether to accept our audit opinion.
Thank you. Any questions from the committee? Joy.
About the comment about the fair value of investments, is that this is the first report that I've received since joining the board. Is that something that's been an area of emphasis in prior audits?
Yes, it is. Okay.
So, do I have a motion to accept the audit?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Thank you. So move on to the next topic, which...
The second thing that we're responsible for is the independent auditor's report or the special purpose audits that were performed over the scheduled proportionate share of contributions, as well as specified captions within the schedule of aggregate pension amounts. As Brenda stated earlier, we determined materiality both quantitatively and qualitatively at this level. So although it is somewhat reliant upon the audit of the financial statements of CalSTRS, which we include in a paragraph in this opinion where we reference the audit of CalSTRS, it was performed at a greater level of detail. That was included in an other matters paragraph. It does not rise to the level of significance of an emphasis of matters, so I'll distinguish between those two paragraphs. We performed these audits in accordance with, again, with generally accepted auditing standards as well as government auditing standards, and we've issued unmodified opinions on both of these schedules. Again, the schedule of proportionate share was taken as a whole, so the employer contributions in total. However, we had to factor in materiality of what is the impact on any given individual and understand that from both a quantitative and qualitative standpoint. From the schedule of aggregate pension amounts, we have determined that we believe that the net pension liability, the total deferred outflows of resources, the total deferred inflows of resources, as well as the resulting pension expense, all individually, not as a collective amount, but each of those individual amounts are also presented in accordance with generally accepted accounting principles and are supported by our audit. So have issued an unmodified opinion there as well. One other kind of key point that I would put or point out within our report is the restriction on use that we include within this opinion. This is a special purpose audit conducted under the auditing standards. And what we're doing here is we're telling people that you have to be a named user of this report in order to rely upon it. The audit of the financial statements that you just accepted is free to anybody who wants to read your financial statements. Here, what we're saying is for these schedules, only CalSTRS, CalSTRS board, CalSTRS management, your employers, and in the state, as well as their auditors, are the only people who should really be relying upon these financial or upon these schedules, because they're really only meaningful to those parties as well. So it does include a restriction of use that is also consistent with what the AICPA has recommended, and it falls under the auditing standards there. That summarizes that report. So, Mr. Chairman, I'll answer any questions related to it, as well as ask you to accept.
Irena.
Yeah, just out of curiosity, who would try to use them and for what purpose, other than the folks that you mentioned?
That's a really good question, and I don't have a good answer. I can't imagine why anybody would read the 120 pages without.
I was wondering if there was some specific reason for the comments.
Well, I mean, the rating agencies are very focused on what these are going to say about the, and it might say about the financial condition of the school districts. But I think what you're saying is they should wait for the school districts to report their own numbers. Okay. Is that right?
I'll move approval of the item.
Second.
Oh, Jack?
I want to ask Robin, how do, on the communication side of this, how do these schedules get communicated back to the employers? Are we doing an active communication around this, or how will that conversation take place?
So we have a planned outreach beginning at the first of the year. So we'll go on the road again with these, because we know seeing the actual results is going to cause there to be another round of questions and answers. We want to make sure we put FAQs in terms of the actual.
But you're not going to 1,600 schools,
no,
I hope.
No, we'll.
Are we actually directly disseminating this to 1,600 schools?
We will. They're on our published financials, so I don't have any plans to deliver them in any other way. And we can rethink that if that's something we want to rethink. But they are posted as a publication, and that's what we've communicated with people, is that they're available through our financial reporting process. So
think about that. Yeah.
That's the plan. Certainly fungible.
Before we vote, Robin, I know you had some presentation materials as well that for tomorrow, but they were also available for today. I didn't know whether there was anything you wanted to be showing to us that.
So I'll leave this to the pleasure of the committee. What I have done in preparation for the communication challenges that we all recognize this causes is to compare from a numbers perspective the calculation of the NPL as compared to the UAO, or the unfunded actuarial obligation, starting at 6/30/13 and then moving forward to 6/30/14, understanding that the basis for our accounting calculations is the same as the basis for our funding calculations from the census perspective. So we have prepared a financial statement overview for the board, and it's scheduled for the regular meeting, and I have embedded those slides in that presentation. I will tell you that as staff, we are somewhat concerned about the nuances in these slides and whether that's going to be informative or confusing. So I don't know if the committee would like to look at them and see what their perspective is, so that you can advise us as to whether you would recommend that we leave them in or take them out. So that's one option that I would propose if you're willing to go through them with us.
What's the committee's pleasure to see that? I'd be interested, but if I'm the only one, I can just ask for the slides myself. Okay. And Bob would be interested.
Yeah.
So I think it would be a good idea.
There are three slides, so we're interrupting a deck that we prepared for the financial statement overview. So,
okay.
Thank you.
Sure.
And okay, great. Thank you very much. This was, I appreciate this. So what we've tried to do here, and this is as of 6/30/13. So as of 6/30/13, we have an actuarial valuation, which the board accepted in April of 14. And then we also have calculated the total pension liability. So what you're seeing here is just a straight comparison between those two sets of numbers, the total actuarial obligation, the actuarial value of assets, and the unfunded actuarial obligation as compared to the total pension liability, the fiduciary net position, which is our financial statement value, and then the calculated net pension liability. And you see differences that we've related here, which may appear, at least in my view, somewhat non-understandable. And again, it's a testament to the fact that the calculations are really different. So the differences as I look at them from a fiscal perspective don't really make sense to me knowing what I know about the programs, and it really is a testament in my view to the fact that the calculations are doing something completely different. So it was helpful to me to prepare this to validate that distinction. So all of these numbers should be correlated with either the actuarial valuation, again, the sum from a funding perspective of DB, DBS, and CB, and then the information that's presented in our financial statements. So before I move on, I want to make sure that there aren't questions about this frame of reference.
So the first column comes from our actuaries?
Yes. Yeah, so what we did is we took the components of the actuarial valuation for DB, DBS, and CB and added those up. Okay, then what we tried to do here was to show you at 6/30/13, if one were to try and reconcile those numbers. So I apologize for the detail, but as good accountants, we wanted to tick and tie all the nuances. And so you see the exercise that we went through, or our staff went through to do this. So the first item, and we're talking first about the liability side, and then about the asset side. And it's important to know that there are adjustments in both places. So the methodologies differ both in the liability calculation as well as in the available asset calculation. So the first adjustment on the liability side is to add in the liability under SBMA to the funding calculation, because as you've said, it's a separate item. Then what we have to adjust for is the fact that the discount rate differs by 0.1% for administrative costs. And that's, again, a mandate from the GASB 67 statement. Then we have to adjust for the fact that the actuarial cost method for the two programs, DBS and CB, is required to be different under GASB 67 than we think is appropriate for funding purposes in the actuarial valuation. So instead of using traditional unit credit, which we use for the actuarial valuation, we have to use entry age normal. Then the next adjustment is for the Medi-Cal premium payment plan, which is again from a funding perspective held as a separate component of the DB base, because the board's decision related to that plan when it was established was to the availability of reserves to pay that liability. Okay, so that's the liability side. So that's how we get from the 230 to the 237, 238. Okay, on the asset side, we take the actuarial value of assets as were included in those valuations, add in the SBMA reserve, take out the additional deferred investment losses, and come up with a fiduciary net position. And then the net of those two adjusted numbers gives us the NPL at 6/30/13. So lots of changes. And I, again, this was illustrative to me in looking at that irrational comparison in my mind, and then to see why, you know, the various components of those adjustments. So does anybody have any questions?
I have one question. The additional deferred investment losses, is that the adjustment from actuarial valuation to market value valuation?
Yes. Yes, because our fiduciary net position is market value of assets. And we still have deferrals in the actuarial value of assets that are rolling forward. Did I?
I see a lot of quizzical faces, but no, nobody
in 5-year period.
Yeah, this is actually going from the 3-year period in the actuarial valuation to the current value in the NPL. Because there's no yet deferral of investment gains in our case. And that's in, again, the calculation of the pension expense, so different. So again, two numbers. Composed, we talk about a net. There are really adjustments on the liability side as well as on the asset side, which has a combined impact on the comparison between the unfunded actuarial obligation and the NPL.
Bob, you look like you were ready to speak.
I like this stuff. But
so do those of us on this committee.
But I think we need to be, Robin, this is wonderful stuff. And it is eye-opening in a sense when you see it laid out like this. But I do have a concern that we can reach a point where it's overload on the board, and in which it's detail, which sometimes can cloud the issue instead of bring it forth to light. And it's not for me to say where that boundary is, but I just wish to express that concern for the board that I think, look, I'm here for the board. And if it were me, I think, this may be getting close to the point where sometimes too much information, where sometimes it might actually make it more difficult to see what's going on than not. But I certainly like the exposure. But I would ask the board that, to what extent do you think it may, I mean, you can't show everything.
No. I mean, I think this has been useful for those of us on the committee. Probably would guess that unless somebody has a question saying, how do you get from one number to the next, that you don't need to volunteer this.
Right, and I think in presenting this here, we are giving you an opportunity, and I really appreciate your input on that because we need it. There is one more slide that rolls this forward to 14. And again, I think I would like to show it to you if that's okay. And this really talks about the changes in the NPL from year to year. Because again, everything was really based on data in terms of the calculation of the liability from 6/30/13. So this is the work that Milliman did for us in terms of, you know, the additional service costs, the interest, the contributions coming in, the investment income, the other income, our administrative expenses, to show you how that liability at 6/30/13 got reduced to the liability at 6/30/14. And the biggest impact is obviously the fact that our investments were significant. So again, just helping to get to those numbers, because from the valuation perspective, we talk about 6/30/13 as being the latest information we have, yet we had to roll forward to the financial statement presentation date. So that's how we did it.
So these are not the actuarial numbers.
No, the contributions, you know, the member and the employer, and the, most of this, the service cost and the interest are actuarial numbers. The other numbers are coming from financial reporting.
The interest is what? Is the 7.5%?
No, it's the interest on the unfunded obligation that gets computed rolled forward. I'm looking to my actuary to make sure I'm not misspeaking. But.
Which is that 7.5%?
I think it's 7.6%.
7%, right. Okay. Okay. Yeah, Joy, sorry.
Investment income, those are just our gains?
Yeah, it's a combination of realized and unrealized gains and losses net, and also, you know, dividend and interest.
So I have a really basic question to ask. Can you go back to your first slide?
Sure.
Please? So the number on the in the left column, our unfunded actuarial obligation, that's the basis on which that's the basis on which the funding legislation that was passed earlier this summer was calculated. It's based on the actuarial valuation as opposed to the discussion of accounting and financial statements and the net pension liability that we're talking about today.
I'm going to answer yes and no, because the yes is it was based on the actuarial valuation, but it was for the DB program. And this is a blend. This is the combination.
This adds in the DBS and the CB.
Correct.
So the fact that we see the funding and the accounting numbers on this page, the net being very similar, doesn't necessarily mean we're going to see it as very similar for 2014 because of the substantial investment earnings that we saw on that third page.
Actually, Mr. Chairman, the point you just made is you may see a lot of volatility in that calculation on a go-forward basis based on the determination of the fiduciary net position and the impact of the investment earnings on an annual basis and the change in fair value.
But on the other side, we also have increasing contributions coming in, so that's going to help the NPO. So, you know, there's lots of moving parts.
Yeah, going forward, right.
Yeah.
Great. I think we can get back to the issue at hand. We had a motion and a second for item two to approve accepting the opinion from Crowe. So it was item three. Sorry. Yeah, item three. Since item one was the agenda. Thank you. So item three. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay. Passes. Thank you. And so now move on to item four.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We're going to call Alexis up front. And, hey, Chuck, I've never booted my CEO before, but, yeah, I appreciate that. We're going to let Alexis come up here and present our required communications to those charged with governance.
It's time for mid-year evaluations.
I would never expect this.
If you could refer while Alexis gets set, this is ARM page 115 is where you can find our communications that Alexis will be referring to. And Alexis, I'll turn it over to
okay.
you.
Great. Thank you for having me. Again, I'm going to go over our required communications. So professional standards require that there are certain communications that we have with those charged with governance. And this letter included in ARM 115 goes over all those required communications. And these are items that are really deemed significant in our professional judgment that need to be communicated and highlighted to you. They're very similar. Some of these items are going to be similar to those communicated in prior years. And I'll go over those still, but at a higher level. And then again, with the implementation of GASB 67 and the new schedules and the special purpose audits, there are things that I want to highlight and go into a little bit more detail. So there'll be some more time spent on that. On page one of the letter, so ARM 115, I do want to highlight on the middle of the page we have combined our communications with the audit of the system's financial statements, as well as the plan and the two schedules that were audited with the special purpose audit. So throughout this letter, there may be instances where our communications apply to both the system's financial statements and the schedules of the plan, and certain items that relate only to one or the other. So I will highlight when those arise. Going forward on page one, two items just to note. Our responsibility under standards generally accepted in the United States of America, as well as our responsibility under government auditing standards, go in, is in detail on the bottom of page one. Specifically for the government auditing standards, we do specific tests to see if there's any non-compliance in those standards, and I just wanted to highlight there were no non-compliance with government auditing standards. That was identified throughout our audit. On page two on the top, it goes over the plan, scope, and timing of the audits. It also notes that this was formally communicated on June 2nd, and I want to highlight that this was actually communicated with Mr. Chairman himself. So it wasn't communicated with the entire committee, but we did have this discussion in private and went over specific bullet points in this letter. Item three, the concept of materiality in planning and executing the audits. Again, I think Kevin and Brenda have both discussed the different materiality thresholds that we had to determine for the system and then also for the plans, because the materiality for, not the plans, but the schedules is much different. So the materiality level for the schedule proportionate share is at a much greater detail because you do have employers that are looking at these schedules, and that threshold is different than the materiality to the system as a whole, or the financial statements taken as a whole. Something new this year is the extent to which the auditor us relied or used internal auditors' work. So again, we worked very closely with audit services, and they went to each district with us and helped in the completion of those 100 school district audits. Moving on page two, critical accounting policies and estimates. These two items that we have identified as critical are also those items that are included in the emphasis of matters paragraphs in the opinions that you've just approved, specifically the net pension liability that we've been discussing in great detail, and then also the fair value of those hard-to-value investments. What hasn't been discussed as it relates to the fair value of investments is actually GASB's requirement of the disclosure of the change plus or minus 1% of that discount rate of 7.6%, and what that would affect on your total pension liability. And that's actually identified in ARM page 41 in the financial statements. It's also included in note 3. So if you were to turn to that, not only has management disclosed the effect of the total pension liability plus or minus that 1%, but they've gone above and beyond and done plus or minus 3%. So it breaks out what that total pension liability would be, plus or minus 1, 2, and 3. So that's something that hadn't been discussed previously. On page 3, significant accounting policies. There were several new accounting policies that were effective for this year, the largest one having the impact as GASB 67. I'm not going to go into much detail on that because I think we've discussed it in our overview. All other accounting pronouncements had an immaterial effect to both the financial statements of the system as well as the plan. There were also two GASB exposure drafts that came out. And this will actually be, Kevin's going to be addressing in future slides, but just wanted to highlight here in our required communications that there are two exposure drafts. Management is evaluating them, and they've actually responded. On page 4, you have management's judgments and accounting estimates. We've talked in great detail about many of these accounting estimates, the fair value of securities, the total pension liability. This area really does go through more the process used by management in determining those estimates, and then the basis of Crowe's conclusion. So did we, how were we able to conclude on that? What kind of tests we performed? And the one item, there's actually two items in this section that I wanted to highlight, really relates to the plan schedules, and that's what's new this year. And that's the revenue, it's actually on page 5, and it's the revenue recognition policy for preparation of the plan schedule proportionate share. Their policy and the accrual process is somewhat was new to us in determining how they estimate those contributions. And under the process used by management, it highlights that the plan accrues employer contributions monthly based on estimates. The state is based on the beginning of each fiscal year. And in their accrual process, contributions and adjustments that come through and that are reported in the current year, but that are related to the prior year, are still being included in the schedule proportionate share for this current year. And that becomes significant, as you'll see later on in this letter, on the effect and our materiality thresholds. Again, on page 6, total deferred inflows of resources and deferred outflows of resources. We just talked a little bit about that. There were no deferred outflows of resources or inflows of resources, and the difference of the long-term rate of return because of the implementation of the current year. So the valuation was as of, all the estimates were as of 13, were the same as 14. And that's highlighted on page 6 and moving on to page 7. I want to focus your guys' attention now on actually the second half of ARM 121, corrected and uncorrected misstatements, and going back to our different materiality thresholds. So for the system, we determine a materiality threshold where if misstatements are identified that meet that threshold, we are required to communicate that to management, and management would record that misstatement. For the system, and actually for both of the schedules related to the plan, we identified no corrected misstatements. So nothing met a specific threshold that required management to book to their financial statements or the schedules. As far as uncorrected misstatements, again, for the system, we didn't identify any uncorrected misstatements. So uncorrected misstatements have a lower threshold, but are still significant enough to where we would communicate it with management, and management could choose to either record or not record those misstatements that we identified. For the system, we identified no uncorrected misstatements. But again, we had a different materiality threshold for the system than we did for the two schedules related to the plan. And because of that, for the schedule of proportionate share, we did have a uncorrected misstatement that's being recorded here. It's also included in management's representation letter, a $51 million. And that goes back to the accrual process for the preparing the schedule of proportionate share, and an over-accrual in the prior year and an under-accrual in the current year, causing this $51 million difference. So it wasn't material to the financial statements of the system, but again, to the schedule it was. There was also no uncorrected misstatements for the schedule of aggregate pension amounts. Other communications on ARM 122 that we would like to have with you, we read all the documents that include the financial statements for consistency. And this includes the MD&A as well as the required supplementary information and other pension information. We didn't identify any material inconsistencies between those documents and the system's financial statements. We did want to highlight, however, that there are some immaterial inconsistencies between the MD&A and the GAAP financial statements in disclosures of investments. So there are some disclosures in the MD&A related to investment that's disclosed in how they manage the portfolio versus the actual GAAP financial presentation that's in the financial statements. So noted that they're immaterial, but we just wanted to highlight that there are some inconsistencies there. Significant difficulties encountered during the audits. I really want to emphasize there were no difficulties encountered with management. They were very great to work with, and again, I want to thank all of the teams that we worked with in completing the audit. Again, it was a huge task. However, on page 123 of ARM, we did want to highlight some difficulties in the performance of the audit. Again, with, I think it was previously mentioned, a condensed timeline between when the financial statements were provided to us in draft with the date of issuance, as well as the fair valuing and the final pricing of some of those hard-to-value investments. It was difficult to meet that time, and there was a very compressed and short time period. Other difficulties in just the overall performance of the audit really just stems from the new GASB 67 requirements and the 100 school district audits that we had to go to visit, to schedule, and to be completed, and we really did that in an eight-week time period. So we hustled and bustled, and we worked closely with audit services, and we were able to complete it. But again, it's just something that, you know, it was difficult to overcome, and hopefully we'll figure it out. And, you know, I think we're in the planning process right now
for next year.
So they're going to start much earlier. On the bottom of ARM 123, disagreements with management, there were none. Again, they were great to work with. I thank them. We're not aware of any instances where management consulted with other accountants. Representations the auditor is requiring from management, we've actually provided copies of those representation letters to you. Significant issues discussed are subject to correspondence with management. We will be going over later in this presentation our report on internal controls, so those are considered significant items and correspondence with management. There were no findings or issues related with related party findings. And other findings or issues that were relevant or significant, again, it's going to be our report on internal controls that we'll go over later in this presentation. With that, I know I went over it a little quickly and in some places more detail than others, but if you don't have any questions, I will hand it over to Mr. Chairman for approval.
Any questions? Bob, do you have anything to say?
Just a couple words. This is an important part of the audit and one of my more favorite parts, because it's communications to those charged with governance, which is you. So it's specifically designed for you, the Audits and Risk Management Committee. So this is really an important document. And it also provides a more informal way to go through some of the things that they looked at, some of the things they did. You see financial statements, you see very carefully worded documents, you see a lot of numbers and a lot of schedules. But this document is really one you can look at and say, I understand exactly what it's saying. I understand what they did, I understand what they looked at. So two things really come out when I read this, which I read a couple times. One is that, good golly, crow's picky. But I like that. But good grief, they're picky. Second, nothing in here caught my eye as having any concern. And that's a big deal, because they looked at a lot of stuff. So I think that really is a testament to the fact of staff. It relates to staff and staff's dedication to address these issues. But it's really important, because it doesn't always work that way. I mean, it does here. You have a highly functioning organization. But out there, it doesn't always go that way. So don't take it for granted. And really, if you're going to read, you should read it all, of course. But this is a pretty important document.
Anything else? Larry, did you?
Reminded the chair, this is agenda item number 4 that we've been discussing, and we do have a recommendation from staff for the committee to accept the report to those charged with governance as submitted by Crow.
And we don't have a specific resolution, I didn't see here, for this, so it's just accepting this, is that right? Okay. Do I hear a motion? Second? All in favor? Aye. Opposed? It's accepted. Thank you. So let's move on then to item 5.
Very quickly, and I won't view this as a continuing education process, I would just label this slide as no rest for the weary. The GASB has recently, within the last 3 years, received a dedicated source of funding. So they are much more active. They have a larger staff, and I would just tell you to expect to continue to hear about new GASB standards. We did list the three either as a new standard or exposure draft that we believe could have somewhat level of a significant impact upon CalSTRS. I'd also like to compliment your staff. Quite often I have clients who first look at GASB standards in the year of implementation. Your team responds to preliminary views. They respond to exposure drafts. They are often test subjects as far as the implementation process goes, and they're very active in the due diligence or in the due process of the standard setting. So I just want to compliment them and tell you that you should be pleased with that process.
Thank you, Kevin. Jack, one item. I'm not sure I want the presentation going to the GASB anymore. The next item is we're going to report. So this covers CalSTRS financial statement audit, the report of independent auditors on internal control over financial reporting and on compliance and other matters based on the audit of the financial statements performed in accordance with government auditing standards. This is a report that we issue every year as a byproduct of the audit. I will direct you to ARM page 126 for the report in totality. But I do want to point out that our responsibility is to consider the system's internal control over financial reporting to determine our audit procedures, to make sure that those procedures are appropriate in the circumstances for purposes of expressing an opinion on those financial statements. And again, we're talking about the system in this case, but not for the purpose of expressing an opinion over the effectiveness of the system's internal control. So it's very important to note that we are not issuing an opinion over the system's internal control in this particular report. What we do want to highlight for you is that as we go through that audit process, as we identify deficiencies in internal controls over financial reporting, we are required under the standards to evaluate the significance of each of those deficiencies. And in the case of this particular material misstatement, if you will, it is a combination of a number of deficiencies that when combined or aggregated together rise to the level of a material misstatement. We have presented this material weakness over member data in previous years. And I don't think that this particular comment is a surprise to anyone in the room. I do want to acknowledge on behalf of management that they have implemented additional controls, and they are working and acknowledge the weaknesses over some of their internal controls over member data. Certain portions of our comment are consistent with previous periods, if you will, but we are acknowledging that management has made, you know, changes in their control structure and are working to mitigate the effects of this material weakness. In addition to that, I want to correlate this to previous years. So in the previous several years, we actually had material weakness on internal controls over financial reporting as well. And that material weakness comment, again, was a combination of deficiencies that when aggregated together rose to the level of material weakness. Those deficiencies, many of them have been remediated and were no longer found in our audit procedures during the current year. And those deficiencies that were not fully remediated at the beginning of the reporting period, so maybe they were remediated somewhere in the middle of the reporting period, or other deficiencies that we identified. As we evaluated each of those deficiencies in internal controls over financial reporting, those items were still classified as deficiencies, so they no longer show up in this letter to you. So again, this year, I think we should acknowledge the progress that the system has made with respect to their internal controls or our financial reporting, and we should really celebrate this material weakness comment that's been out there for 4 years has been remediated.
Yippee, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Not sure if it's yippee for us or yippee for everybody else.
Well,
but
for everybody.
It is. Yeah.
Well, for you to, I mean, I if I could just say something, I mean, we're very appreciative of the focus that you brought to identifying this and to helping the system identify how to remediate it and then to staff for doing such a good job of remediating it. And I think, you know, in some ways we weren't sure it was going to get remediated by this year. So, I mean, it's really it's a great accomplishment. And so, you know, everybody should be happy and should be congratulated. So thank you all.
Mr. Chairman, if there are no questions, I believe we want to ask the committee to accept our report as it relates to the audit of the financial statements of the system.
I don't see any questions. So can I have a motion?
Second.
Moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? It's accepted. And again, thank you very much. This is really a wonderful accomplishment. And, everybody is to be congratulated.
There's one more key item or deliverable, if you will. And so when we talked several times about the standards in which we performed the audit of the additional schedules of the strip, due to the government auditing standards, we also are required to issue a report on internal control over the financial reporting with respect to those schedules. And it's important to note that many of those numbers, if not all of those numbers, are derived from the financial statements of the system. Therefore, what you're going to find is we also have a material weakness comment identified with respect to these audits, which is a byproduct of the audit of the system, which contains the strip, if you will. You will not see any previous findings. This is a brand new engagement, a brand new audit, so it doesn't necessarily correlate to the previous year in terms of findings in the past because we have not performed this service. But it is a separate deliverable as required by the standards. So it will tell you the terminology embedded within this letter, which is ARM 135, I believe.
135.
Yep, ARM 135 is very consistent. It just strictly identifies the difference between the two audits and refers to our audit of the schedule of proportionate share, each of the elements, the schedule of aggregate pension amounts.
So could you identify the because my pagination is different than yours. It's
ARM 135 is not consistent
no.
with.
So you're talking about page
one.
Page one that.
Of
the second. Okay.
It's ARM 135.
Right. So those.
He said it's not agreeing to his book.
So that looks very similar to.
It's very similar. I didn't provide it in track changes, but it's pretty similar.
The date is the same, the title is the same.
The words are the same.
Yes.
The words are the same.
Except for the first paragraph. That is correct. And no additional update as to previous findings because previously we weren't engaged.
Right.
So with that, I would also ask you, Mr. Chairman.
Can I just ask a question? So what does this mean then I understand this is new, so it doesn't track from a previous, but this is a material weakness that's identified just because since we still have the material weakness on member data that then sort of automatically we have this material weakness with respect to the proportionate share calculations, is that?
So member data is used to determine three things within the financial statements. The contributions that come into the strip,
right.
So the funding, the benefits that are paid out of the strip, so all of that member data that's aggregated together and used to determine someone's benefit upon retirement. And then in addition to that, it's all the census data that's used to determine the total pension liability under 67. So when you look at these additional schedules, the first schedule covers contributions and the schedule proportionate share. But then in addition to that, if you look at the schedule of aggregate pension amounts, many of those items are a byproduct of the audit of CalSTRS. So I don't think it's mutually exclusive, if you will. I think this comment, because it applies to member data and the impact of the financial reporting of the system, would therefore also apply to the financial reporting of these schedules.
Got it. Okay. You stated it better what I was trying to state, but confirmed my...
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
...understanding. Thank you. Anything else on this? Do we need to accept this then separately?
Yes, so I believe this is item number five. If I can count fingers correctly, item number five that you're being asked to approve.
Okay, yeah, I think we think we already took one vote on five, but I think we're taking a second vote
on five.
There's
two different items on five within the agenda. I apologize.
Okay. Yeah. So, second? All in favor? Aye. Opposed? Great. Thank you. It's accepted.
And Mr. Chairman and members of the Armed Committee, we do have one additional item that Kevin is actually going to present to you. And this is actually a letter to management. Anytime we identify deficiencies.
Let me just note that
we'll
take this now, but it's actually out of order and the agenda because the next item is the approval of the minutes. But I think we're talking now about the independent auditor's report to management. Is that the item?
Communications
okay.
to management.
That's fine. Let's go ahead with that. Yeah, sure. For continuity's sake.
So this letter actually covers deficiencies that are reported to management. They're not required to be reported to those charged with governance, but it was management's decision to be transparent and present this letter to you. So I'll hand it over to Kevin.
I would just echo what Brenda said. So as we identify weaknesses in internal control, we're required to evaluate how to classify them: material weakness, significant deficiency, or just a deficiency. This is the first year that we've actually reported a management letter to management, because of previously all deficiencies identified when evaluated either individually or collectively rose to the level of a material weakness or significant deficiency. Management has made significant efforts in remediating many of these findings. However, some of those findings still exist. But when we evaluate them both individually and in the aggregate, they did not rise to the level of a reportable condition, a significant deficiency or material weakness. I believe Dr. Yetman would echo that the auditing standards have set the bar relatively low for it to be a significant deficiency and therefore required to be reported to the board. So for it to find its way to the management letter, in my humble opinion, it means it's not something that the board needs to be worried about. However, management, in their efforts to be very transparent with you, has included it within this agenda. I just tell you that it's a place that the deficiencies that have not been completely remediated have been communicated to management, and it allows them to track progress as they correct them on a go-forward basis. The findings primarily relate to certain issues within information technology as well as audit services and are very consistent with elements that were found in the significant deficiency and material weaknesses reported in the prior year. With that, we're not asking for any type of approval because, again, it's a report to management and not the board. But I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Any questions? Okay. Thank you. Thank you. So I think that then concludes all of the presentations and approvals, and I thank you very, very much, everyone, both with Crow and with staff. We're going to go back to item six, which was an action item. I think that's why they were not consecutive on the agenda. Thank you very, very much. Really appreciate it. Thank you all for being here, the whole team. Thank you, everybody in the audience. Everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you. So let's go back then to item, I think it's six, which is approval of the minutes from the September 4th Armed Committee meeting. Are there any questions? If not, can I hear a motion for approval? So moved. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Great. That's approved. So now we go to item eight, which is the real estate investment audit report.
Yes, thank you. As part of the audit plan that was approved by the committee, an audit of CalSTRS real estate investment operations was performed by Macias, Ginny, and O'Connell. Today in the audience, we have a representative from MGO and also from the investment office here today to answer any questions that the committee might have regarding this audit. The purpose of the audit was really to evaluate the internal controls and also adherence to established policies and procedures within the real estate section of the investment office. It also included auditing of the investment selection and acquisition process, due diligence, partner selection and monitoring, as well as asset valuation, wire transfers, and cash flow reconciliations. And that was really kind of the scope or emphasis of the audit. The audit report is included as attachment one of this agenda item. The audit did not really include any what we would term as a high risk findings, but it does identify opportunities for strengthening internal controls and also for ensuring that real estate policies and procedures are up to date and accurately reflect their current practices. Also, the processes are that they're documented and maintained. And additionally, there was observations that really were designed to enhance operations, including verifying distributions, reviewing all of the partnership financial statements, and ensuring property managers address critical findings. So the real estate staff reviewed the findings from the auditor, concurred with those findings, prepared responses that are included in the audit report. As they implement these corrective actions, audit services will continue to monitor that and will follow up with management and then periodically report on the status of those items to the Audit and Risk Management Committee. So if there's any questions from the committee members, we're happy to answer those at this time. If not, this
well, is... I do have one question. So if you look at page 11 of the report, so there's two pages starting there of internal audit objectives. So is this just sort of after the audit, sort of an appendix that says, here's what we were trying to accomplish in the audit? I wasn't quite sure what this two pages was saying.
Yeah. Yeah, and I just tried to summarize those really kind of at a high level. And so what they do is they the auditor provides kind of an overview and the scope of the internal audit. And then this attachment really kind of takes a deeper dive of, here's the specific items that we looked at, and here was the objectives of our review.
Okay, but this mm-hmm. isn't, but it's not reporting any audit findings here. This is just
no,
the
this
list
is just
of
outlining
what was
their
done.
Approach.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
okay. Good, and this is not an action.
This is
item.
An information.
This is
item.
Just an informational mm-hmm. item. Okay, great. So, thank you very much, and. Then review of information requests, did we have any?
Just reinforcing that we are bringing a legal issue to the board related to the responsibility and the structure of the various programs, cash balance, DBS.
Okay. I don't think there was anything else. So the draft agenda for the next committee meeting is item 10. Information item, but does anybody have any comments or anything on that? Okay, well, then I guess we can move on to item 10A, which is opportunity for statements from the public. Seeing none, I think we're adjourned. Thank you very much, everybody.